بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم والعاقبة للمتقين أما بعد. Respected scholars, elders, brothers and friends, Alhamdulillah, we have all gathered here in order to try and find some common ground in order for us to reach a solution to some of the communal problems that we have been witnessing for a while now. And Alhamdulillah, this initiative that has been taken up, it's a noble initiative, it's a noble endeavor, and we have full anticipation and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that inshaAllah a solution will be reached, inshaAllah. The thing is that the first thing, we need to sit down here with a clean heart and with our sights on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the sense that whatever it is that we want to achieve, we want to achieve it solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It all starts from there, the niyyah and the intention. So inshaAllah, our gathering here is solely for the sake of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and helping the community towards unity and uniformity inshaAllah. Without any further delay, inshaAllah, I'll get started with the presentation. And I was asked to share the shari'i and the fiqhi, the juristic views in respect to global sighting. So, as we all know, there are four schools of Islamic law, Islamic jurisprudence that are adhered to throughout the world. You know, we have the followers of the Hanafi fiqh, the Shafi'i fiqh, the Hanbali fiqh, and the Maliki fiqh. And all four schools have their respective views in relation to this particular issue. It all starts with... We will start with the majority view, inshaAllah. And that is, according to the three schools of Islamic law, the Hanafi, the Maliki, and the Hanbali, they are all of the view that one single horizon is sufficient for the entire Islamic nation. That means, when you look into the books, it basically implies that if someone has viewed the moon, they have sighted the first moon, right, in a particular region, that sighting, provided it is verified and it has gone through the necessary processes of verification, whether it's two individuals testifying in court and the judge is ruling according to that sighting, whatever the verification process is, once it has gone through that verification process and approval process, that one sighting is sufficient for the entire Muslim nation. And this basically is a really non-complicated and uncomplicated view. So this is something that we all want to understand. According to the majority, one sighting that is verified and gone and has undergone the approval process is sufficient for the entire Muslim nation, irrespective of where they are residing. The second is... Sorry, it looks like my iTunes here wants to mess around with me. I'm trying to, it's being stubborn with me. Okay. The second is the Shafi'i view. According to that particular school of Islamic law, they are of the view that we will have separate and divided horizons. And what is that view basically? How is that applied? Well, they used to use a different standard of measure in those days, known as farsakh, the singular of farasikh. That would translate today, the measurements that they have taken, that would translate today as 133 kilometers. So within a parameter of 133 kilometers, if the moon is sighted anywhere, well, that is going to be sufficient. That sighting is sufficient for that particular parameter. It is not sufficient for anyone outside that parameter. To try and put things into context, that would look like from Brampton to Port Hope. Now I'm from Brampton, that's why I chose Brampton. Okay, so from Brampton to Port Hope, you're looking at approximately 133 kilometers there. So if it was sighted anywhere within this one parameter that we have made for ourselves, that will be sufficient for the residents of that parameter. Anyone outside of that, it will be insufficient for them, and they would have to resort to their own sightings. And if it was not sighted, then they would have to complete the current month as 30 days and then resume or commence the next month after the 30-day period is over. Now, I just wanted to share the background briefly behind these views. This is a very deep fiqhi discussion, and right now we don't have the time, and nor do we have we don't have the time to go into all the depth of these particular discussions. But just to give you an idea of where these views are being generated from, right? Just an idea. We're just scratching the surface. Keep in mind, this is not like the all-conclusive argument that is being presented by both parties. It's just to give you an idea, okay, of where those views are being generated from. So you have the views being generated, number one, primarily from the sacred texts, like the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's words. Then you have the next step, which is basing it on analogy, and then you have some of the logical rationale and reasoning behind it. We're just going to focus on the prophetic traditions. And the first three views that we had, or the first three schools whose view we had shared, it primarily is generated from this one narration of Sahih Bukhari, hadith number 1909, according to the Darussalam prints. Remember, the numbering, it changes based on what print you're purchasing. So based on the Darussalam prints, I mean, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said to the near meaning, "Sumu li ru'yatihi wa aftiru li ru'yatihi fa'in ghubbi alaykum wa fi riwayatin fa'in ghumma alaykum fa'akmilu iddata thalathin," aw kama qala alaihi salatu wasalam. Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that you fast upon viewing the first moon, and you will cease the fasting period after viewing the first moon. So that's basically the first moon of Ramadan. When that is viewed, then you commence the fasting period. And when the next moon of Shawwal, that when that is visible, you will cease the month of Ramadan, and you will now begin the new month of Shawwal. And if it is not visible, then you're going to complete 30 days. فَأَكْمِلُوا عِدَّةَ ثَلَاثِينَ. Now, in this particular narration, what you find is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spoke in the general tense. And there's this fiqhi principle, الْمُطْلَقُ يَجْرِي عَلَىٰ إِطْلَاقِهِ. Anything that is general, it will be applied in a general fashion. You're not going to add any, you know, make any specifications, and you're not going to restrict it. Okay? So basically, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he has made this general statement, it will be taken as general. And this is the way it has been understood by these three schools. One thing I did want to point out, that this particular narration in a few various forms has been narrated almost 70 times through 11 Sahaba. You want to make a note of that. To be precise, based on the research, it was 77 ahadith with this message coming from 11 different Sahaba, which according to some standards, it reaches the standard of tawatur, something which is basically decisive. It's a decisive text. Hence, this will make these words a decisive statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the way it is viewed by these three schools. What we find is, when it comes to the Shafi'i school, they make it a bit more specific, and they resort to the hadith which has been recorded by Imam Muslim rahimahullah later on in his compilation, the Sahih. And I'm sure we have heard of this narration where you have Quraib that was sent by one of the Sahabiyat to Sham. He was a resident of Madinatul Munawwara. He was sent to Sham, which currently today is known as Syria. In those days, it was a region that encompassed Syria, Palestine, Jordan, a little portion of Libya, a little portion of Iraq, a little portion of Turkey. It was a huge region. And Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he was the emir down there. So he was sent for a task down there. He fulfilled the task, and while he was there, they viewed the new moon, I should say the first moon of Ramadan, on a Thursday night. He himself had witnessed it, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, and everyone had witnessed it, and it was declared the next day, which is the Friday, it was declared as the first day of the new month of Ramadan. Quraib, rahimahullah, he stayed there, and he then traveled back to Madinatul Munawwara, where he encountered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's cousin Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, and he inquired as to what the situation was down there in Sham, when the moon was sighted, and what decision was made, and so forth. Keep in mind, remember, means of communication were very limited in those days. They couldn't just tweet things and post it on Facebook or whatnot. Not in those days. So after doing this little investigation, Quraib, rahimahullah, he had related what had transpired. But Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he related that here in Madinatul Munawwara, they had viewed the first moon on a Friday night. Okay, so there's a conflict in sightings. And so basically they had commenced their new month of Ramadan on a Saturday. So Quraib, he posed a question to Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, which you can see here, that will you not suffice with Muawiyah's viewing and his fasting? And Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma's response was this: no, this is what Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has instructed us. هَكَذَا أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ. And this hadith, you can view it for yourself in Sahih Muslim, hadith number 2528, again according to the Darussalam Prince. So this is where that view is generated from. Again, there is a deeper discussion to this. This is just scratching the surface, just to give you an idea of how those views are being formed. Now, after sharing those views, it's really important that we be practical rather than hypothetical. Normally what happens as a community, we get lost in becoming so hypothetical that we become divorced from the practical situation. And I think in my personal view, that needs to be changed. We need to be really practical about our situation. And hence, on that note, what normally happens, the moon sighting really becomes an issue only on three occasions throughout the year for the wide Muslim community. Okay, really we make an issue out of it on three occasions throughout the year. When are we going to begin Ramadan? When is Eid al-Fitr? And when is Eid al-Adha? So basically the new moon, or the first moon for Ramadan, the first moon for Shawwal, and the first moon for Dhul-Hijjah. That's when we're really making an issue out of this. I mean, look, this whole year has gone by. No one really brought this topic up. And now because Ramadan is around the corner, the topic has come back up again. So that's the practical situation. Right? These are the months when we really get together and start as a community. Yeah, you have a committee which goes on throughout the year that are doing the sightings and verification and so forth. But as a community, it becomes a concern on these three occasions primarily. Now, when we look at some of the tables as to where the moon is appearing, alhamdulillah, we're honored to have Dr. Saab here today, and I'm sure I don't think there's a single person here that has not gone on his website. Right? Everyone knows it, it's globally renowned, and on that, if you go on the website, you're going to have these visibility tables. And I wanted to just show some of that, just to show you the practical situation. Now here you have the visibility table, okay, and I've just clicked on, I'm just clicking right now, Ramadan 1433. Okay, so what we are going to see, and you're going to see this to be a consistent trend, that when it comes to the visibility and the appearance of the first moon, it is normally appearing in the Western Hemisphere first. And within the Western Hemisphere, I mean, basically what you're doing is you're splitting the world in half. So this from here onwards is the Western Hemisphere. Okay. So what are you doing? Let's split this in half. That's the East. This is the West. Okay. So what you're going to see normally, this is consistent trend that it's normally appearing in this area. You've got that circle. Okay? Now, let's just go through some of them. Let's look at Dhul-Hijjah or let's look at Shawwal. Okay? It's not really cooperating with me. Okay, again, look, you see the red line from here. Let's look at Dhul-Hijjah. One thing I want to show you the consistency of, and you can go on this yourself and check it out yourself. It's always starting from this end here. Okay, it's not starting from down there. Okay, the visibility, it really is beginning from this area here. And we are living right there. Okay, this is where we are. We're in Toronto, we're in Canada, and hence on that note, what we want to really do is see what stance do we want to adopt in order to make it very feasible for the immediate community. Okay? Now, if I can just quickly go back to my presentation. Okay, if it was to be visible in the east, for example, if that was the case, it definitely has to be visible in the west, as you can see, as we've demonstrated it on those tables. Except if the whole of the western hemisphere was overcast or something, which is very unlikely. Someone's got to sight it somewhere in the west if it's being sighted in the east. And provided we're going with the philosophy of divided hemispheres. Okay? So, I would want to finish off with these recommendations. I do have to leave, unfortunately, immediately after this for another program. So hence, my recommendations and my to everyone that's attending here is, first, define the area where unity and uniformity is required. Define which area do we want to really focus on. Do we want to focus on the entire world? Well, we know for a fact that's going to be very impractical. Okay, so as a group, we need to define the area that we're concerned with. After that, define the parameters in a fashion that will not put the community into hardship. And after that, we design a body that will advocate this procedure to all Islamic organizations in the defined parameters of the communities in the defined parameters. These are just some thoughts I wanted to share on this note. And that being said, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up the way, inshaAllah, towards community cohesion, getting together and working on a united platform. Wa akhiru da'wana, and alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.